You guys sometimes feel like the person, the guy, trying to tell someone the truth of the situation? It's really hard sometimes just to point out exactly what's actually taking place. They don't want to hear it. They sometimes let their emotions of the situations override it. And honestly, our world has kind of taken this whole idea of truth and kind of twisted it. We have these half-truths, these false truths, and other type of truths, but really in the scheme of it, they're all not true. But we've kind of explained them that way. Wow, I clicked too easy. I gotta get used to this thing. Okay, sorry. There is real truth, and we know what the real truth is, but we so often let the emotions of the situations cloud the truth of the situation so much. Let's read 2 Timothy 2, 4, 1 through 8. If you guys got your Bibles, I encourage you to open there. The 2 Timothy 2, 4, 1 through 8. I'm going to be jumping around a lot in 2 Timothy chapter 4 and a bunch of other spots. So if you got a bookmark or something you want to wedge in there, that'd be perfect. So let's go about this. I solemnly charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with great patience and instructions. For a time will come when they will not endure sound doctrines, but wanting to have their ears tickled for themselves, teachers in accordance to their own desires. But you, be sober in all things, endure hardships, do the work of an evangelist, fulfilling your ministry. Amen. For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. In the future, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will reward to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing. Let's pray. Father, thank you that we can come into your house, Lord, and just open our hearts. Lord, Paul wrote something so long ago that's so applicable to today. Lord, help us to dwell on it and kind of rip it apart and actually feed upon the scriptures right here to actually find out what true truth is that spans all of eternity, Lord, and how we can take it out into the nations and into our own lives and into our own heart ourselves, Lord. Lord, speak to us today. In this way, it's in your son's name we pray. Amen. Amen. So let's go back to verse 1. I kind of like to do a little bit of exegetical type stuff. So we're going to go verse by verse pretty much right through this passage, the first 5 verses. Verse 1, I solemnly charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead by his appearing and his kingdom. So how do we determine what real truth is? If you had to sit down and write out what truth was or what is true, how would you define it? And I got people waving their Bibles. That's the Sunday school answer right there. And it's right. I'll give you that. But it's sometimes hard to define in today's culture because we've twisted it so much around. So to actually have truth defined, you kind of got to have a judge to say what is true and what is not true. And that is laid out in kind of this first verse here, where he says that we have a judge and that the judge is God through Jesus Christ. Now, some people say, wait a second. Jesus didn't come into the world to judge the world. That is true. On his first one, he didn't come here. If you look to John 3:17, it says, for God did not send his son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him. In his first coming, he didn't judge. He just came to show himself to us. But the second coming, and if you jump to Revelation 19:11-13, it says, and I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he, that is Jesus, who sat on it, is called faithful and true, and is righteous. He judges and wages wars. His eyes are a flame of fire, and on his head are many dominions. And by the name written on him, which no one knows except him, he is clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. Very much so. That's why The Sunday school answer is so correct in this scenario. But also, let's look at what Paul dealt with when he was going through a missionary journey, and he was actually in Greece and up on the Sermon on the Mount, or the Sermon on Mars Hill, some people will say it that way. Therefore, having overlooked the time of ignorance, God is now declaring to men that all people everywhere should repent, because he, Jesus, has fixed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness through a man whom he has appointed, having furnished proof to all men by raising him, Jesus, from the dead. Amen. He's coming back to judge. Romans 2:16 even talks about it more. But you, why do you judge your brothers? Or you again, why do you regard your brother with contempt? For we all will stand before the judgment seat of God. Everybody's going to be judged. All truth will be laid before. And then John 1:14. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we saw his glory. Glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. Amen. We have a powerful judge, a judge that we serve with our lives, who has been there since the foundations of the world was ever laid. If you really think about it, and so this judge is eternal. This judge of eternal truth is through all times. And that's more specifically said in John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word, Jesus. And the Word, Jesus, was with God. And the Word was God. He, Jesus, was in the beginning with God. Amen. Always been there. Never been about it. So why is this important? Well, if you look at culture today and you look at the idea of truth, it crumbles upon itself. And if you go back and you look at all the great philosophers and theologians of the day, and you take all their fundamental ideas and you start analyzing it and trying to build it upon itself, it'll eventually collapse also. Because its truth is temporary. It is not eternal. It is made by a man who is temporary, not eternal. And it may seem like I'm really driving this home, but that's the point of this whole sermon. King Solomon had it right, I believe, in the very end of Ecclesiastes. If you really want to read a sorrowful book, go to Ecclesiastes and read. But at the very end, I'll save you the last chapter. In the very end, he says, the conclusion, when all has been heard, is fear God and keep his commands, because this applies to every person. For God will bring every act to judgment, everything which is hidden, whether it is good or evil. So where do we go from here? So the first verse of the 2 Timothy 4:1, we really find out we have a judge who has spanned all times, a judge of truth. So let's go to verse 2. I must have went too far. Back one. Oh, that's the laser button. Too many buttons on here. They need to have one. Verse 2. Preach the word, be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with great patience and instructions. There are three main things Paul's calling out here. First one is to preach the word. The second one is to be ready in season and out of season. And the third one is to reprove, rebuke, and exhort with great patience and instructions. Let's look at the first one, preaching. What really is preaching? If you had to boil preaching down, and you actually went down to its Greek form and stuff and actually started tearing into it, it's this idea of a herald, someone proclaiming something that's about to happen, either for good or bad. We have the pleasures of internet and all kinds of other media before us. We can turn the TV on and see what the news is. But in the old days, the kings and the emperors, they would go find an individual who was of good character and integrity, and then they would appoint that person to go out into the nations and proclaim the king's wishes. How did they proclaim? They didn't go out and go, I'm a good person. No, they went out and spoke. They went out and actually proclaimed with their mouth. Verbal communication, preaching, it has to do with the oral aspect of it. We are to preach the word. This is where I kind of like this quote, commentator in this one statement here, McGee, he stated, says, we are not to preach about the word of God or from the word of God. We are but to preach the word of God. So often we dodge one way or another and we preach about God. We preach from his word. But do we really preach the word of God? Actually take it and make it alive and make it dwell in someone's heart. Who is the word of God? I've already stated that. It is Jesus. If you go back to John 1:1, John 1:14, and Revelations 19:13, it specifically states that Jesus is the word of God. In and out of season. Why? Why do we need to preach and be ready to preach in and out of season? Because you never can predict when God will have an opportunity right before you to do your work. I kind of like to think of a diligent farmer here in his work. At one time in my life, I used to work for a farmer up in Iowa, and that fall, I was assigned the task of being the combine driver. He gave me the combine, gave me the owner's manual that was 300 plus pages, says, read it, you run it. Okay, it's in my job description. I'm going to be a combine operator. So I learned that combine in and out, through and through, how to rotate the rotor, how to clean out if it got clogged, how to change the oil, how to even change the tires. I prayed that never happened because they're really big. But the reason I had to be so proficient with it was the moment that farmer said, today's the day, that combine was fired up and went straight out into the field. And every night when that combine came in, even if we had rain the next day, I would stay up and work on that combine, fixing it so that the next moment it could go out in the field, it went back out again. Many nights, only a couple hours of sleep, running on a harvest crew. But I was ready in and out of season with that combine. The other thing was at the end of the season, when all the fields had been harvested, over 2,000 acres we rolled across, taking corns and beans off in Iowa. We brought the combine in, and we completely went through it. I mean, there was not a kernel of grain left inside that combine, not a speck of dust anywhere. I can remember standing on a ladder, waxing the side of this combine, and seeing my own face in the reflection, and looking at it going, wow, that's cleaner than the dinner plate I'm going to eat on tonight. And that combine was put away with a full tank of fuel, a brand new oil change, and everything was ready. So all you had to do was get in the seat, hit the ignition, and out to the field you went. Because it had to be ready no matter when. In season and out of season. A diligent farmer maintains that. How often do we treat God the same way with our lives? Where we are ready in and out of season. Do we take the time to sharpen our own tools to be ready for when God says now? Now's the time, seize it. To preach the word wherever you are. Wherever your field is. And whenever you're ready. Now, I'll be honest. When I first got on that combine, I was a little awkward and a little, I've driven big equipment before, but it was odd. I had to practice. I had to take time to actually figure out how to drive the combine around. And at the end of that season, I ran a 25-foot draper head, which would probably be about from, I'm guessing, here to that wall long. And I could cut around a 4x4 post and not hit it. Because I had spent the time to practice in it. And to use it to be proficient. We need to seek places to practice preaching the word of God. Amen. Those times can be in small groups, in Bible studies, quiet times. One place I've really found is journaling, where you sit down and you have a conversation with God as if he's a non-believer. Amen. On how to approach him. And we need to know what tools we also have at our disposals. You've heard Tony speak about the three circles. If you haven't heard that, I suggest you go grab them and ask him about it. Also given a 15-second testimony. I heard that one a couple weeks ago. A guy told me about that. Or even just given a 5-minute testimony of your life on where you were and where you are now with God. Amen. You got to know what your tools are so that you know how to use them. It doesn't matter what the tool is. It's only a matter of you being familiar with it so that you can use it on a moment's notice. That is the key. You got to know how to use it. Now the third one. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort. Let's roll back to 2 Timothy 3, 16 and 17 here. It's just the last verse of the prior chapter, or last couple of verses. It says, all scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproofing, for correcting, for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be adequately equipped for every good work. This ties directly into the reprove, rebuke, and exhort. Those are three hard words to say, especially the first two. Reprove. And this took some time for me to figure out. What's reprove? It means to show fault. That doesn't sound very acceptable if you're going out to someone in the faith or not of the faith and saying, here's what you're doing wrong. It's not taken very goodly. Rebuke. To warn or to forbid. Ugh, that's not very receptive easier. Exhort. This one means to ask, to beg, to plead, to comfort, to encourage. Okay, I can live with the encourage part there with the exhort. But all three are definitely on the position that they are need to be ready to do at a moment's notice with anybody that you run across that is asking for treatment to know who the truth is. This verse, though, in chapter 4, verse 2, it's a conditional statement. It says, with patience and instruction. That's a conditional statement. The way, let's go back and look at that a second. It says, in and out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with, that's a conditional aspect, with great patience and instruction. If I went up to anybody and I started rebuking them or reproving them or exhorting them, they probably wouldn't take it very good. They would negative aspect all the way around. They would definitely reject it. But if you use patience and instruction, it gets a little bit easier. It's a little bit more receptive. At one time in my life also, I ran a hay hauling crew. This machine here had the nickname Daisy. She was a do-easy hay machine, would stack about 210 bales on her in about 15 minutes. Wow. Three guys. One driver, two stackers, 15 minutes to load, and we could unload it in about 25 minutes also if the barn conditions were right. We rolled over 200 bales an hour off this thing. But to drive it, it was a beast to drive. The shifter on it, it was a manual, no automatic here. It was built back in the 60s. Had a manual. The manual pattern was completely backwards. Next to the shifter was another lever that ran that snout up and down. And then next to that shifter was another little lever that ran the chain forward and backwards that took the bales from the front to the back, or from the back to the front. And as you're driving through the field, you are working all three levers simultaneously and a steering wheel, a clutch pedal, and a brake. Oh, let me forget. The brake, you got to double pump because it bleeds off. Typically, I drove this machine. But there was a few occasions I had to have one of my crew guys drive it. And let me tell you, I could have stood over that guy and said, quit grabbing second gear. Be easier on the clutch. You got to double pump it. I could have really tore him apart. But what I found better was if I actually just stood behind him and held on for dear life through a field bouncing around like crazy and said, good job. Why don't you grab another gear? Why don't you slow down a little bit? You're going to be going up that hill. Why don't you pick that snout up and so you don't shove it into that bale right there and run over the one over there? That's how you have patience with instruction. It takes time. You got to have a position that you put yourself in to be receptive. Verse 3. Actually, no, I got one more thing there. But it must be you must take the role of a servant teacher. That's a very big part. There's a servant teacher. You aren't there just to teach. You're there to serve. A servant teacher is one who sits there with them through their struggles and successes, not judging them upon their actions, but one who guides them through their struggles of their actions. You got to guide them through them, even the good and the bad. It's where our world comes so far, because when things get hard, the emotion flag goes up, the stop sign goes up. I'm done with you. I'll move on. I don't want to deal with your situation anymore. I don't want to deal with your truth that you're having. As Christians, we need to actually step back, settle down, get in the rut, and actually start plowing with them. Verse 3, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but wanting to have their ears tickled, they will accumulate for themselves teachers in accordance to their own desires. And then verse 4, and they will turn their ears from the truth and will turn aside to myths. How sad. turn from myths, or turn from truths to myths. Peter expands a little bit more on this in 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 through the beginning of 3. He says, But false prophets also arose among the people, just as they were also be false teachers among you, who will secretly introduce destructive heresies. False truth is always done in secrecy. It's never blatant. It always comes in a little bit. Even denying the master who brought them, bringing swift destructions upon them, many will follow their sensuality. There comes the emotional part of it again. And because of them, the way of the truth will be mangled. And in their greed, they will explode you with false words. Such a bad part. We must be careful as speakers and hearers. Think about that hearing part. We must be careful as speakers and hearers of the truth that we don't fall into these ruts. I'm going to go on a sidebar here. If you see anything I speak false, I want you to pull me aside and let's dig through the scriptures together to find out what is the truth that's in God's word. And if I see anything in you, I hopefully will do the same thing. I want you to take the same approach with me that Priscilla and Aquila took with Apollos in Acts 18, where they pulled him aside. He had the truth, but he didn't have the full truth. They pulled him aside and says, here's what you really need to know. And let's go through this together. I ask that you do the same thing of me and with each other. Amen. That keeps this verse from happening. It removes it. If it's actually done in acts of love, keep in mind, I'm reproving, rebuking, and exhorting in patience and instruction. You got to get down in the trenches and dig through the words together. Amen. It is easy to accept things that we want to be told. So true. The world desperately grabs on that. But it's hard to accept the truths of what we aren't doing. Let me read that again. It's easy to accept the things that we want to be told, but it's hard to accept the truths of what we aren't doing. Let's hit on this sound doctrine. Sound doctrine is truth. They go hand in hand. They're equal. If you were doing a math equation here and you wrote sound doctrine on one side and then did an equator sign and then wrote truth on the side, they weigh the exact same. Sound doctrine and truth are one and one here. All truth must stand the test of time. Period. How can it be true otherwise? It's got to stand the test of time. It's got to be the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Let's look at some examples that were thought to be true. So if you actually go to Job 26:7, there's some interesting verses here. He says, he stretched out the north over empty space and hung the earth on it. Up to about 350 years ago, mankind believed that the earth either sat on the back of an animal or on the back of a being, was carried around by it. Well, science has definitely proved that wrong. But this was written over 3,000 years ago. Let's go to another one, Leviticus 17:11. For the life of the flesh is in the blood. We know that today. Science, yeah. But in the 19th century, they didn't know this. They would used to blood leech. How many here know what blood leeching is? Where they'd actually cut open a vein and let the blood come out because they were thinking that would remove what was ever killing them. But in actuality, most of the time it killed them. A great example of this that a lot of people credited to his death was George Washington, our first president. He was blood leached. This one I love. Psalms 8:8. The birds of the heavens and the fish of the sea, whatever passes through the paths of the sea. I want you to focus on that last part there, paths of the sea. There was a captain named Matthew Murray who used to sail the oceans, and he was a biblical man. He read the scriptures, and he's reading along through Psalms, and he comes across this verse, and keep in mind, his occupation is the sea, and he sees this paths of the sea, and he goes, I don't ever see a road map on the sea. It's all water. Where's the paths? And he actually started to look for them, and he found them. Keep in mind, this guy lived from 1806 to 1873. And through his studies and research of the oceans, we now have the ocean currents, where ships are able to cut down their routes by weeks in this time period when he was sailing, because he figured out where to pass the sea. And he made this statement. He says, and he concluded that if it is in God's word, it is true. Amen. It is true. And there's many more here. You can go to Isaiah 40:22. Talks about the earth being round. Job 38:35. Light waves and radio waves traveling at the same light, speed of sound. They travel at the same rate. Their speed's the same. And Genesis 2:1, law of thermodynamics is laid right out there in Scripture. So I ask this question. If these secondary truths of the Bible, where God's just talking to people, is known to be true, how much more important is what the Bible's main point is, which is his son, Jesus Christ? They are not the main point of his word, but Jesus is the main point. Let's remember back to John 1:1. It says, we will see the word, Jesus Christ, was before time exists. Thus, Jesus Christ is eternal truth. Now, the itchy ear parts. Yeah, I've never really been one for itchy ears. I don't really even like to touch my own ears. But I have a dog at home. Her name's Mia. She was kind of dumped on us. She weighs about 120 pounds. She's a massive something mix. And poor little girl, whoever had her before, actually cut her ears off to make her look mean. But she runs up to me when I get out of my service truck and I park it in the barn. And she runs up and she flings her head against me and she wants me to scratch her ears. That's what she wants. She wants to be scratched. Paul makes an analogy, comparison here, of people running up to these false teachers and wanting their ears to be scratched. We need to avoid itchy ears like a dog greets its master. It's like a dog greeting its master for a good scratch. But we need to dwell on the truth through practicing it, through teaching it, through reading it, and most importantly, through proclaiming it before men so that they will not be caught in the snare of the devil laid before them. The devil doesn't want the truth to be revealed and laid out before them. If you go also in 2 Timothy 2:26, it speaks about the snares. And they will come to their senses and escape from the snares of the devil, having been held captive by him to do his will. Luckily, these men stopped seeking to have their ears scratched and went to where truth was. Lastly, verse 5. But you, be sober in all things, endure hardships, do the work of evangelism, fulfill your ministry. Sober in all things. What's that mean to you? When we are sober, we have a clear mind. It's not being clouded. Our judgment is fully there. And we're able to endure the hardships that we're going through. We know what we are doing. Which leads right into the next part of the statement that says, endure hardships. Speaking the truth, you got to have a sober mind to speak the truth so that you will not be swayed away. Speaking the truth is not always acceptable in this world. If you went up to even some people who claim to be Christians and started speaking the truth, bad day. Not a very good day. It's like vinegar on a wound. But we need to endure for the prize that is laid up for us in heaven. Amen. Last part here of 2 Timothy 4:7-8. Paul knows what's coming before him. He knows what his deeds are through his faith will read. And it says, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. And the future is laid up for me, the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only me, but also to all who have loved his appearing. And then if you also roll into the later on in the chapter, verse 18, I don't have the slide up there for this, but you can see it in your scriptures. In verse 18 of chapter 4, it says, the Lord will deliver me from every evil deed and will bring me safely into his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. We're going to have hardships. That's no doubt. Anytime we're here on this earth, we live in a fallen world. Hardships are going to be here no matter how great of a Christian you are or how much of a pagan you are. You're going to go through hardships. But you got to endure. And you got to endure to the end. Keeping in mind that verse 18. the kingdom that's to come. And last part there is to do the work of an evangelism. Back in verse 5, Paul is calling Timothy to do the work of evangelism, to preach the word. Preaching the word is done by actions and by words. They go hand in hand, as I said before with heralding. We're not called to be good people. We are called but to tell people verbally with our speech and proclaim the word to people. That's our job, is to proclaim, to verbally say it. You can be a Christian and sit in the pew all day you want, but not until you actually get up and actually start speaking the word, you start proclaiming the word. Your actions only go so far. Now the application aspect. How are we going to preach the eternal truth to Jesus? Have you guys thought about that? We need to start with the plan. Every employee of a job has a job description. If an employee does not do all of their job descriptions, are they being a true, faithful employee? My job is a land surveyor. One thing I'm supposed to do is get there every morning and fill the truck up with supplies. If I came in and filled all the truck up with supplies except the wooden stakes, would I really be doing all my job tasks? No, those wood stakes are needed. They need to be driven in the ground to let people know where something is. Preaching the word verbally is part of our job description as an employee. It won't be taken easy at times. I can think of a time in an environment where I was working, and we need to be looking for environments where we can preach the word. I was working for a guy, and his two boys actually worked with me on heavy equipment, and I can remember standing on top of a semi tire over an engine, doing the valve lash on the engine head, and having a verbal conversation with the man's son. And we're talking about Jesus and talking about kingdoms and all these different things. The next day, his son wasn't there to work with me. I later found out that I was starting to speak truth into his son's life that made him question his dad upon what actually was the truth of the scripture. And the dad pulled the father away from me to not work with me. Now he did come back and we started talking again. I didn't back off. But there was days that the son was pulled away from me because I was speaking the truth. I was just asking him plain questions. What's the scripture say about that? Show me where in scripture you believe that. Well, that's what our pastor says. Okay, where's your pastor get it from? Well, it's got to be in God's word. Show me. We need to look for environments. These environments can be work, home, relationships, families, schools, anywhere. The eternal truth that we need to be sharing is not bound by a specific place or time. It's eternal. As long as we are in this world, we need to be sharpening our tools so that God can call us at a moment's notice to stick them in the ground and actually cultivate his kingdom. Let us not forget Paul's statement here in 2 Timothy. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. In the future, keep in mind, this is future, this isn't now, is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing. We still have work to do. If you are here on this earth, taking a breath in and out, heart is beating, eyes are open, and mouths capable to speak, even people who can't speak, they still preach God's word by writing things down and communicating. We still have work to do. Let's pray. Father, thank you for being a God that's holy, one that's amazing. Thank you for sending your son to this world to be the truth to this world, Lord. Thank you for giving us the scriptures that we can dwell upon it to actually see you. Father, I ask that if anybody here doesn't know you, Lord, that they will actually dive into you and start indwelling you in their lives. Lord, and those that do, Lord, I ask that they have more of a desire and an appetite for this eternal truth. Lord, help us in all we do.
Father, if there's anybody here today, I just ask that they get to know you in their full sense. Thank you in your Holy Son's precious name, in Jesus Christ. Amen.